talking about clichés. Good evening. In order to get a better measure of somebody's influence or public weight, it is sometimes very helpful to listen to the judgment of a friendly competitor. The managing editor of Foreign Policy writes about our guest of tonight, David Ignatius, I quote, "Ignatius is far and away America's must-read columnist right now. Iggy has always been known for his top-notch sources, especially in the intelligence community. But his columns seem especially well-sourced of late. If you want to know what the Obama administration is thinking, read David Ignatius." End of quote, and bad news, David, the beginning of our expectations. The US-European relationship has often been described as an old couple which lost a lot of its mutual interest in each other. To me, it seems more that Europe used to be the formerly favorite wife of a powerful polygamist called United States. The polygamist always had other women around the world. He's a guy of many interests and means and can afford more than just one wife. Europe was his favorite for a long time. But now the polygamist is turning Pacific. He doesn't leave his old wife, he just adjusts, chooses a new Asian favorite with younger, more sex appeal, more dynamism, and a livelier future. David, you've just, as we heard, been to the Munich conference this weekend. How much will the old wife, Europe, in future have to look after herself, despite all the lovely rhetoric we got from Joe Biden?
Let me first thank everybody who made this possible. It's wonderful to have a friendly competitor, that is really a friendly competitor who said that about me, say nice things, but it's, you know, even nicer to be in Germany, getting to meet new people and talk to absolutely fascinating contacts. It's nice to be an Allianz Distinguished Visitor. I feel very distinguished. And it's nice to be a guest of the American Academy in Berlin. So I thank Gary, I thank all of you for coming here tonight.
You sound like a German politician first thanks his voters.
Well, thank you, voters. Okay. I'm thanking my contributors, actually. My voters, I don't know. So Joe Biden came to Munich to make this characteristically Biden-esque, histrionic declaration of love to a European, I'm going to use your analogy, mistress who's come off her deathbed. I mean, this is like a piece of opera. You know, the poor mistress looked like, you know, she was dying and then she was recovering and she was dying, and now she's back. And here's Joe Biden saying, "I love you. I've always loved you. You're the cornerstone of my life." And I thought it was a really interesting and honestly, I thought it was a significant speech. Joe Biden is good at saying things that people want to hear. That's part of his political skill. But I would urge you to see his speech in the context of an administration that feels it is recovering from this very difficult, very traumatic period of wars that didn't go very well. Went through a period last year of thinking that its traditional alliance partner, Europe, really couldn't solve its problems. Was looking to Asia, thinking first, we're ending these wars, which have been so draining. We need to turn our attention to what really matters, which is, for all of us, the rise of Asia and of China, but also worrying that Europe wasn't getting the job done. And so we've seen in the last few months, I thought this was one of the really interesting themes of the Munich conference, Europe come back. And international confidence that Europe is going to be able to solve its economic problems, that, as I said earlier today at another meeting, that that your chancellor has found a way to, in effect, ride two horses at once, to say that she supports the Bundesbank and to, in effect, support the European Central Bank, even if their policies would appear to be contradictory. Your chancellors pull that off. And so I think Americans who were really worried that Europe was not solving its problems, kept talking about a way out but not finding it, I think Americans feel much more confident. So I take the Biden comments seriously. I think the question now, as always in this alliance, is what do we do? You know, it's great to be in love, but you know, this is an aging couple, and what are we going to do? How are we going to have some fun together? Yeah, can we have a free trade and investment agreement?
Great fun.
You know, that's as Biden said, can we do it on one tank of gas? Meaning, can we do it quickly? Are there ways that the U.S. and Europe can cooperate on other security issues? That's a long-standing problem. As the U.S. Licks its wounds from Iraq and Afghanistan, we are going to look to Europe increasingly to help us address key security issues in your neighborhood, in the Mediterranean. Look at Mali. Look at the French in Mali. So I thought this conference sounded some themes that are important. We'll talk about others in Europe, understanding where America is as Obama begins the second term after all this experience he went through in the first.
Maybe we can come back to the European U.S. relation a little more in depth later. But let's first look sort of at the broader picture of Obama's second term. As we all have learned, the first term is there to practice, the second then is for real, and for the history books. I mean, The Economist already showed President Obama sort of looking into the mirror, what will they say about me in the history books? What is your reading of him? Will he turn to foreign policy? Will he develop a grand strategy? Is that going to be important for him, somebody who has economic problems at home to solve? What do you expect from his second term in terms of foreign policy?
Let me just first say a few things about Barack Obama as a person, as I have gotten to know him a little bit face-to-face, but more as a journalist covering him. He remains, for me, a mysterious person. He is, as the French say, caché. There's a way in which he's hidden, hard to find. For a very successful politician, elected president, re-elected president, he's not a very political person. There's a dryness about him. Our image of politicians, at least mine, is people like Lyndon Johnson or Bill Clinton, who just are hungry for people, who draw on the feeling they get from an audience and play it back with that kind of, it's almost an animal magnetism that they show. Barack Obama is a very different personality. He really is dry. One of his closest aides once told me that he thought, in truth, Obama would be happier as a Supreme Court justice than as a president. And in his principals meetings with all of his NSC advisors, it's said that he just listens. And sometimes at the end of the meeting, he won't tell you what he's decided. He'll tell you the next morning. So this is a different kind of president, and we've all been trying to understand his leadership style. If you want to think about this man in his second term, the best thing to do is really to go back and reread Dreams from My Father, his first autobiography. It's really one of the best political memoirs I've ever read. And it's the story of this fascinating, self-created person, this man of an African father and a white mother who, in a sense, has a self-created identity. And so, again, we've been seeing that identity play out. I felt, when Obama was elected for the first time, that he had an opportunity to be a great president, in the sense that the country clearly, in 2009, was looking for somebody who could pull the country together. I mean, interestingly, both Obama and McCain, his opponent, campaigned as the people who could cross party lines. John McCain was then famously the Republican who worked with Democrats, and he got the nomination. But as you all saw in Obama's first term, that ability to reach out to Republicans, to forge consensus legislation, to transcend party lines, just didn't work. He managed to get reelected president by one of the most brilliant pieces of political strategy I've ever seen. I mean, if you want to see the technical side of politics practiced, I think, as it's never been done before, look at the Obama campaign. And all the criticisms I would have of Obama as president, that he's not strategic enough, that he doesn't execute adequately, those were all reversed in his political campaign. His top advisors, especially a man named David Plouffe, said at the beginning, this is not a campaign about 50 states. It's a campaign about 9 states, which are the ones that they identified. So they put all their resources in terms of advertising money, candidate travel, all that attention into those key states, knowing that the other ones basically were decided one way or another. You weren't going to move the meter much, but you could in those 9 states. I think they won 8 of the 9. And they did it using campaign techniques that have never really been seen at this level. I was talking to a top Republican strategist right after the election, and he said, we're spending our time trying to reverse engineer what the Obama campaign did because it's so revolutionary. We've got to figure out how they used iPhones, social media, targeting, all these tools with such sophistication. We have to figure it out or we're going to get clobbered in 2 years and 4 years. So to come back to Theo's question, he's been reelected. If he could govern with as much strategic focus and clarity as he campaigned, identifying the 9 problems that he wants to solve and then systematically going out and trying to do something about them, he would have a chance to be a very successful president. He needs to do that first on domestic issues, and I have to say, I think he's off to a bad start, frankly. I was really hoping that he would reach out, not just the people who voted for him, but to the people who didn't vote for him, and try to forge a broad consensus deal on the key debt and fiscal issues. He didn't do that. He went the opposite direction. Will he do it on foreign policy? I think he's a man who's in retreat. You know, he's like a wounded animal, just doesn't want to go near trouble again. But he has a Secretary of State in John Kerry who is enormously ambitious, who's been waiting for this chance his whole life, who's got it, and who I think Kerry will push Obama, push the administration towards greater involvement in foreign policy. We'll talk about the details, but that's how I'd start off, is see Obama in those terms, as this mysterious person, not a typical politician, but with an incredible technical skill for politics that he now needs to apply to governing.
It was always said that Obama, in his first term, met on several occasions with leading historians, also questioning them about the way of great presidents into the history books. Would you read that as a sign that this is for his second term, and the second term is then to make a stamp in history as a president, which he already has, being sort of the first black president anyway. But do you read his personality as somebody who will just go along smoothly now, or is he somebody who will surprise us with a grand strategy, either at home or abroad? And you know, you said he's not strategic enough. Will that stay the case?
I don't know. I mean, I think that America and the world need a great American president, and I would love to think that Obama could be that leader. But his first job is to find a way to make a political system in Congress that's basically broken work again. I mean, you know, we have a real problem. We can't pass budgets. We can't pass fundamental legislation on immigration. I mean, see how that, well, it's an issue on which there's consensus about what to do, but the ability to get it done is going to break down. So somehow, in the way that Lyndon Johnson did as president, in the way that Bill Clinton at his best did it as president, in the way that Ronald Reagan did, he has to find a way to govern over the top of this broken Washington, connect with the people, and just get that energy and power. And we'll see. Again, I hoped that he would give an inaugural address that would open a process of ambitious policy. I wrote a column just after the election when I remembered when Lyndon Johnson took the White House after the assassination of President Kennedy. Lyndon Johnson had been a quite unpopular figure in Washington. And his key advisors gathered around him a week after Kennedy was shot and essentially argued for caution. The country doesn't know you. Be careful, Mr. President. And Johnson responded, and this is from the new biography by Robert Caro, which I really recommend to people. Johnson responded, "What the hell's the presidency for, if not to do great things?" And I'd love to see a little bit more of that spirit in Barack Obama. What the hell is the presidency for unless I go out and connect with people, unless I break this crazy logjam in Washington, unless I figure out a way to make a big deal on the budget, not little deals. So that's the spirit I'd like to see again. He is a restrained, careful person. You couldn't imagine a person more different than Lyndon B. Johnson than Barack Obama. So can he do it? I don't know.
In his inauguration speech, he did not talk about a better world. He talked about a better state. Europe wasn't mentioned at all. Is that sort of our perspective looking at the speech, or would you read from it?
I thought it was really disturbing how little the president said about the world in his inaugural address. And I think Europeans and every people around the world should be bothered by it. It was just almost mentioned in passing. Frankly, I didn't think that he had a lot to say about key U.S. problems either. To me, the most memorable line in the address was when he talked about our gay brothers and sisters, and it was just a way of saying the world has changed. I'm going to use this language in this biggest American speech. Because that's where the country is now. So I thought that was important, but on almost every other issue, I found it disappointing. His aides say I called the speech pedestrian in a column, offending the White House, and his aides say, "Well, wait for the State of the Union. He's going to give a really great State of the Union speech." So we'll see. But he, you know, I just want him to amp up. As my daughters would say, I want him to get more energy, because I think without that, you've got to get this broken Washington off dead center.
I was in Washington at the time of the election, and it was said that he had learned that lesson, that he saw that his non-involvement in so many political dealings in Washington had cost him a huge price. So what I learned from you and your perception of him, he probably hasn't, and it won't change. What would be a lesson we could learn? I'm sort of the formerly favorite wife. Is there anything Europe can do, can help reach out in certain policy matters, in issues we should get him involved? Is there anything Europe can do?
Well, that's an interesting question. I think just Europe being back, Europe solving its own problems, Europe having, again, economic momentum is the most important thing. Last year, there were just too many problems on the menu. And so, what Europe should do is what Europe is doing. And your chancellor is obviously the key personality, and I think looking at the engagement of Obama and Germany, Obama and Chancellor Merkel, is going to be one of the more interesting foreign policy issues. You know, I think one thing Europe can do is make sure you send out invitations to Joe Biden, because you know, Biden increasingly has been used by the president to do the things that he either doesn't want to do or isn't very good at. So when you need that big, emotional, sloppy, wet kiss speech to Europe that Barack Obama, you can't imagine Barack Obama giving that speech, and it wouldn't go over if he did, but send Joe Biden. And so I think that's, you know, maybe that's the guy.
There are people in the room who can who can invite. Would it be a way, I mean, Obama sort of hit a nerve here in Europe when he said in Australia that he's the first Pacific president, US president. Do you feel it helpful or necessary if the European Union has an own Pacific or Asian policy to get involved? If that's sort of the new area of concern of President Obama?
Well, quite apart from whatever benefits it has for the United States, and I think it would have some, it's obviously crucial for Europe, individual nations and collectively, to have a strong, clear voice in Asia. The rise of China is the big event of the rest of my lifetime, I think all of our lifetimes, and there are people who will tell you that this story is going to end unhappily, that it's just not the case historically that nations rise as rapidly as China has risen and compete with nations as much as China is already competing with the U.S. and will do more without there being an element of confrontation that emerges. So, you know, one thing that can reduce that possibility, I think, is for Europe with the United States to play a balancing role in Asia to the extent that a strong Europe is present in Asia. I think it makes it harder for China to play this as a bilateral confrontation. So, but you know, in so many ways, U.S. and European interests operate in tandem in Asia and are going to be complementary.
The first experiences with President Obama were sort of a mixture of him being rather soft power and diplomatic and sometimes tough. What do you expect him to be in a forthcoming conflict in any, however it will show, between China and Japan? I mean, he declared where he's siding, but how tough will he be if these two sort of preposterous powers really become entangled?
Well, just to say a word about China and how I read U.S. strategy and action. I think if you asked any prominent American strategist, starting with Henry Kissinger, to explain the U.S.-China relationship, they would say that China made a decision that it was in its interest to follow behind a powerful America. And as I said in another session, you know, much as race cars follow behind each other and get extra speed by following in the draft, that's what China's been doing with the United States. So I think China, in truth, has an interest in a strong America, paradoxically, strong enough. I think the United States, for all its worry about China, has been very careful not to exploit weaknesses. And the example I would cite is China last year, after the scandal of Bo Xilai, this very senior official, who was discovered to be involved in a murder through his wife, and a wild corruption scandal, and a police chief who defected to the American consulate in Sichuan. In other words, it was a period of maximum vulnerability for the Chinese leadership, who knew that this story of Bo Xilai and Wang Gong was repeated all over the country with different party leaders. The United States knew chapter and verse what had happened the moment the police chief walked into the consulate, and the U.S. had to decide whether to let him defect or not. And interestingly, the United States didn't say a word about it. there was not a public hint of what was going on until the Chinese disclosed it. And I think that what that tells you is that the United States policy is to be protective in a way of China, understanding that you don't want this country, as it grows and develops, to just to shake too violently. That's not in our interest. The other thing I would cite is the way in which the U.S., and Biden talked about this in his speech in Munich, the U.S. worked with the new Chinese leader, Xi Jinping. Biden visited him in China. Xi Jinping came to America to see Biden. And again, the rite of passage for a Chinese leader today is to be embraced by the United States. So whenever we hear the rhetoric of confrontation, I think we need to think, what actions does the United States actually take? Fairly protective. What actions does China actually take? Again, fairly cautious. So I don't think that, despite this historical analogy, I don't think that the confrontation is inevitable, but I do think really careful management, we'll talk maybe in more detail if you want, Theo, about the developing confrontation in the South China Sea is going to be crucial. I know the White House in the last few weeks has really gotten concerned that the possibility of miscalculation by China, by Japan, is getting dangerously large.
Thank you. There's so much knowledge in the room here that I don't want sort of to have a bilateral discussion for too long. I'd like just to touch on two issues before we open up for questions and comments. One is on Friday at the Berlinale here, we will have the opening of a movie about fracking. I.e., in a few years we will have, if all the predictions are true, the U.S. being the leading producer of oil in the world before Saudi Arabia. Question to you, what will that make with the U.S.? What will it make with your relationship with the Middle East? And consequently, then for us, it has sort of huge consequences. If you could just give us your thoughts on that.
I thought one of the most interesting moments in the Munich conference was when Mr. Jane, I think his name is Anjus. Anjus, okay. Talked about changes in the world, the way that Europe is coming back. And then talked about the implications of America becoming a dominant, low-cost producer of energy and electricity. And he said, if I'm remembering correctly, we see a strong America for 20 years out. And I think the effects of that psychologically for a world that was beginning to genuinely worry about American decline, in particular economic decline, but all of the consequent linked factors, the implications of that are enormous. The danger is, obviously, that the United States no longer feeling that its economic life hangs on this delicate thread that originates in the Gulf in Saudi Arabia will retreat from the Gulf. I mean, the danger is less for Europe, I think, than it is for China. I mean, if I was China, I'd really be worried. That they've been getting a free ride with the United States, maintaining security in the Gulf and the area where they get their oil, maintaining open sea lanes so that oil can transit. What would happen to China if the U.S. really did begin to pull back and became as mercantilist as China and said, "Sorry, we're not going to pay the bill for your security"? And that's a fascinating issue to think about. I think, to be honest, people in government and people outside like me are just beginning to get our minds around this. The other thing that I would just note, Germany is an example of why it really matters to pay attention to making things as opposed to making financial products. I mean, I think it was Herr Steinmeier who said on Friday, we love manufacturing. Manufacturing still really matters to Germany. Well, one consequence of having is astonishingly low-cost energy and consequently low-cost electricity, is that the U.S. is going to become a low-cost place to make things again. So there is this movement that consultants are beginning to write about. Boston Consulting Group has had a series of studies that they're calling reshoring, meaning bringing manufacturing that went to Asia, that went offshore, back to the U.S. because it's more secure, because the costs are competitive, because there's just a lot more stable situation. So the implications of that are really startling. Beyond the energy itself, it's all the things that flow from having abundant and low-cost energy.
Not just in Delaware. There's one more point I'd like to get your expertise, and then we open up for questions. Syria. You've been to Syria several times, latest in autumn, and also, as Gary mentioned, in Munich, your podium was quite interesting. Maybe you can give us some insight.
So I do a lot of foreign travel, but I would say that the trip that my wife least enjoyed watching me take was into Syria in October. I did it just because I really was having trouble understanding what to say about policy. And as crazy as it was, I traveled for a couple days with the Free Syrian Army, went to Aleppo, saw the tragic destruction of Aleppo. I did come out understanding some basics. And, you know, I mentioned these on the podium in Munich, but I'll just briefly tell them to this audience. First, the rural north of Syria, now really the whole rural part of the country, is gone. The idea that the Assad regime ever can govern again is just... you see with your own eyes, it's not just not possible. You travel for hours without encountering the Syrian army. You know, the country has just lost that central government control. Second thing you see is that the opposition, although it's fought very bravely, is a mess. It's just so disorganized. It's a bottom-up revolution. It's created so many different groups that compete for power. Now in the areas that are liberated in quotation marks, you have essentially banditry in which people just extort money from the people who are now under their control. That's really disturbing. That's, I think, largely the fault of the U.S. and other powers for not seeking to coordinate this resistance when they could have done it. And then finally, you see, tragically, the rise of extremist groups, in the case of the most powerful group, directly linked to Al-Qaeda, who are now the strongest force on the ground. I mean, that's just, it's amazing that we are supporting in Syria an opposition whose strongest element is explicitly linked to Al-Qaeda. You just have to think about that and then ask yourself, what are we going to do about that? I mean, there are a limited range of options, but that's what John Kerry has to think about. I wrote this in a column yesterday. That's, you've got to get his mind around that and think, how do we use policy to increase the leverage of more responsible Syrians? Or more to the point, how do we draw the Russians into a process of political settlement here? And let me just close with that. As Gary mentioned, I had this interesting panel on Friday night, and it was interesting because the head of the Syrian opposition, Sunni Sheikh, Sheikh Muaz al-Khatib, who was elected head of the opposition coalition, who had said last week, a week ago, that he was prepared to negotiate with elements of the Assad regime and was attacked for it. And, you know, this is a crazy opposition. So people denounced him, how dare you, these are killers. He said it again on the podium in Munich. And I thought that was important. And more to the point, Lakhdar Brahimi, the special representative of the UN who was sitting next to him, said, this is a new path forward. This is important. And most important of all, the next day, Sheikh Muaz met with Sergei Lavrov, the Russian foreign minister. And Lavrov said publicly after the meeting was over, this is important. This is something new. This is something we can work with. And if that wasn't enough, the Iranian foreign minister also met privately with him and has been saying to people that Iran thinks it can work with this Sunni leader who's linked to very anti-Iranian elements. So in the space of a few days, there's been a little bit of movement, and the movement is toward, I think, toward greater Russian, maybe Iranian involvement in a process that would lead to a political transition. Sheikh Mawaz has identified now the person in the regime who he'd be ready to sit down with and start negotiations. So, you know, I mean, this war is destroying Syria. As Brahimi said, this is becoming a version of hell. And I feel a little bit more hopeful than I did that there's a diplomatic way out.
Great. Thank you very much for first opening a lot of doors. If there are questions in the room, comments, please introduce yourself and maybe the...
Yes. Thank you. Please raise your hand. Yes, sir.
Second row, the lady in the red.
Sorry.
I think you should force John Kornblum to ask a question.
On Broken Congress, Elizabeth Pond, World Policy Journal. On the Broken Congress, sitting here in Berlin, I cannot understand why the Democrats didn't change the filibuster rule when they had the chance. Could you enlighten us on that? And one further question, and that is, can you conceive, as some of its enthusiasts do, that a transatlantic trade and investment agreement might take the place of NATO as the chief glue between the U.S. and Europe?
First, the filibuster rule. The only thing I can say, Elizabeth, is that this just showed what one would have suspected, which is that senators love their own personal power and prerogative more than they love governing. That's shocking. You know, could that really be true, that they put their personal interests ahead of the country? Well, I mean, that's a definition, sadly, of what it is to be a member of Congress today, is it put your personal interests ahead of the collective interest. It's just sad that happened. On the transatlantic trade and investment agreement, this one is sort of sneaking up on everybody. I mean, the Germans have been talking about it. Everybody's been talking about it for years, and it's one of those ideas that's so wonderful in practice, but everybody would go, well, it'll never happen. And if you can't pass a WTO, how would you ever get to the more complicated particular issues between the U.S. and Europe? And yet, here it is. Biden mentioned it. Biden said, I want to get there on one tank of gas. I'm told, we'll see, that the president's going to mention the State of the Union address. Does he have the political oomph to actually get it through a Congress that can't do anything? If you can't pass immigration reform at a time when the country's driving itself crazy about this issue, how are you going to pass something that affects a lot of special interests and that will upset banks, will upset farmers? I mean, you know, name me a group that isn't going to be upset by this. But, it's a really good idea. I think President Obama has shown that, and I think that the Democratic and Republican leadership have shown that they do understand the importance of resisting populist pressure against free trade. I mean, if there's one, and you would have predicted, given all of the economic difficulties the U.S. has been through recently, that people would have said, well, we have to fight for ourselves. You know, the hell with these foreigners. You know, let's protect our markets. It's a classic response, but it hasn't happened. And it hasn't happened because there is a big consensus among the American political elite that's a bad idea. And I would think there'd be a consensus that this is a good idea. This is a way to encourage growth in Europe without further subsidies that Europe can't afford, a way to encourage U.S. exports to those markets. So we'll see. I mean, let's watch how if President Obama says it in the State of the Union, how he says it, and then what the follow-up is.
Thank you very much. Question over there. Should we pass the mic on?
I have a quick question, but maybe important. Of all the many things went wrong in the foreign policy of this administration, but the one which is, at least to me, the least explicable is Middle East George Mitchell. That started with such a fanfare. It wasn't only George Mitchell, it was several other well-known Middle Eastern experts. And it really went nowhere, absolutely nowhere. Can you do you have any thoughts on why? Was George Mitchell just tired, or was Israel too recalcitrant, or what happened with that whole complex?
Well, that's an all of the above question. If I were to identify the single most important mistake that the president made, there was a choice that they faced in early 2009, whether to essentially take the past agreements, the so-called Clinton parameters that were agreed at the end of Clinton's term, other statements that have emerged in negotiations. It's now known that Ehud Olmert came very close with Mahmoud Abbas to having a deal. Olmert prepared a map that details the boundaries of the future state. He offered a tentative settlement on Jerusalem. There was a formula for refugees. I mean, every key issue. I mean, this is one of those problems where we know how it's going to turn out. That's not the question. It's just a question of having the political will to get there. So at the beginning of the Obama administration, there was a question, should we just present these parameters and say, this is the position of the United States is that these elements are the basis of a solution. And essentially just say to the parties, this is it. So let's do it. Let's get down and then begin to apply pressure. The alternative route was the one that was chosen. And it was the traditional, let's kind of start from the beginning and let's send George Mitchell on shuttles back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And, you know, let's, you know, create the whole thing again de novo. Meanwhile, let's make settlements the issue as a way of building confidence with the Arab side and taking advantage of what was seen as Netanyahu's weakness. And it was a mistake. I mean, not to put too fine a point on it, it was just the wrong choice. I watched as, I remember the confidence of Obama, of Biden, of Rahm Emanuel, that you know, they had the muscle. They had just won. Netanyahu was weak. You know, we got him. We're going to roll him on the settlements issue. And I remember the first time Netanyahu came to Washington, he was shocked by how powerful the president was. He went up on the Hill, went to see Congressman Waxman, other key congressional leaders, and he was basically rebuffed. I mean, they stood behind the White House. And then he watched as 2009 continued. The president got caught in that debate over health care. He began to decline in popularity. He just got stuck in the mud. And by the fall, when Netanyahu came back, and then even more into 2010, Obama was weaker by the month, Netanyahu was stronger by the month, and suddenly this whole strategy just was dead in the water. So I think I would identify the core mistake that I mentioned. I wish they'd chosen the alternative path. They have a choice again whether to do that, and I hope they'll do it. You know, the final thing to say is, to negotiate a peace agreement, you need parties who are prepared to negotiate a peace agreement. And the experience of the last 4 years told President Obama that isn't the case. And I think he feels so burned by this. I think, again, John Kerry wants to do this. Does Barack Obama want to jump back into this one? We'll see.
Can I just add a question to this? I mean, the foreign secretary wouldn't make his first three calls to the Middle East if he hasn't sort of the agreement with his president, would he? And if he has consumed the mistake as you described it, it would be surprising if he either completely shies away from it after John Kerry's start now, or commits the same mistake again.
Well, I think Obama, in his heart, feels as passionate about the need to have a solution to the Israeli-Palestinian problem as he did 4 years ago. I mean, don't forget, it really was the first thing he did. The first interview he gave was to an Arab television network. The first print interview he gave, I think, was to... He did everything he could to make this issue a centerpiece. And I think he'd still like to do it. He has a Secretary of State who wants to be a shuttle diplomat, but who also, I think, believes in this idea of making clear what our parameters are at the outset. I think that's where Kerry is. But we're going to have to see. He's going to have to, these are very tough decisions. Kerry has a very good relationship with Netanyahu, which is going to be important. Obama made a big mistake also, it should be said, in not going to Israel. I think he undermined his ability to be a peacemaker and a broker by having no credibility in Israel at all. And that somehow he's got to reverse that also.
Yeah, thank you. My name is Patrick Keller. I'm the coordinator of foreign and security policy here at the Konrad Adenauer Foundation in Berlin. Thank you for an interesting conversation, but there was one thing that puzzled me. You were both asking whether President Obama will produce a grand strategy on foreign affairs in his second term. And I think he already has produced such a grand strategy, and it's very clear and coherent to me. And that's the first priority, to do nation building at home instead of doing nation building abroad. That's why he extracted American soldiers from Iraq, and why he started doing so from Afghanistan, and why he has refused to play a leading role in Syria or in Libya, leading from behind. At the same time, he's not isolationist, and he's not withdrawing from the world. He's not naive about the threats. He's just using a cost-efficient way of dealing with threats from afar, like drones in Pakistan, like cyber attacks on Iran. So taking all that together, to me, is a very coherent approach to international affairs in a security policy perspective. And it means for Germany and for Europe that we will have to do more on our own, that we will be responsible for sharing more of the burden on establishing security in the European periphery, in Northern Africa, in the Middle East, on the Balkans, everywhere, really, in our neighborhood. So this is more of a comment than a question, but I'd be curious to hear your views on that. Thank you.
Well, the first thing I would say is if the Obama administration could articulate its strategy as well as you just did, they'd be better off. I mean, that's the best simple statement of what that, I think you're right. I think that is what they're doing. The problem is, first, it isn't sufficiently articulated, and second, it is a strategy in the negative. It's a strategy about we're not going to do this mistake that we did overseas again. We're not going to make big bets on uncertain outcomes. Which if I looked at the president's policy decisions in the Middle East since the Arab Spring began, what I would say is that he has, knowing that the outcome of this process is uncertain, and also knowing that you can't stop the process. This is just this is a revolution. It's just happening. That you shouldn't place large bets on uncertain outcomes. So the U.S. isn't going to do that. It's going to try to keep dialogue open. It's going to try to avoid, irrevocable moves. It's going to try to keep its distance. It's going to try to avoid becoming the issue, making the U.S. the issue again. And again, that sounds good. The problem is that as I look at the consequences of that policy in Syria, I see a problem getting worse and worse. If Syria becomes a safe haven for people who are essentially affiliated with al-Qaeda or share that jihadist ideology, the danger for Europe and the United States is enormous. I mean, it's really, this isn't Afghanistan or this isn't South Waziristan. This is the Mediterranean. This is on at our door. So as much as I understand and sympathize with the broad strategic framework, I would say if we keep doing what we're doing, we're going to get in real trouble. The country's going to break up, and it's going to be a base for people who will threaten us for a long time. So either by somehow convincing the Russians not to act so crazy and to be part of a solution, or by doing something that tips the balance in favor of the rebels and gets the regime out,
we've got to change this trajectory, because the trajectory we're on is the breakup of Syria and very powerful jihadist groups that will be a danger, I think, of the dimension that I described.
My name is Imo Staber. I'm a former ambassador. I would like to ask you this. I'm very much.
There's a microphone. Thanks.
I'm very sympathetic to.
Wait a moment.
That's all. Very sympathetic to Obama, and I think I thought, and I continue to think, that he is great progress compared to his predecessor. But the character you described, Obama's character, it's sympathetic, but I think you gave him, in a sense, a raw deal. Why? Because he was given the situation that he found when he became president, that was dumped into his lap, was such that one can be, he just had to keep his head above the water. And I think he was completely absorbed with the management of the financial crisis, which explains a lot of things. On the other hand, I think you didn't mention that, and I would like to hear your view on that. He is something new in America, because many American presidents have been to Paris and London, and not many to other places. But he had a view of the world as a young man that other presidents haven't had. And I think you can notice that. And I think it's a wonderful thing to hear that somebody gets together, discusses an issue with his advisors, and then says, fine, I'm going to think about it. That's a good way to go about these things, instead of having a seminar, as the very sympathetic Clinton had, which lasted for hours and didn't come up with a result, non plus. So, I would like to hear your views on these remarks.
Well, again, that's well said, and... Obama is, you could argue that he is something so new that we just don't really have the language yet to describe it very well. I thought when he was first elected that he talked about being a post-racial president, that he was mixed racial ancestry. And I thought, in a weird way, he's a post-colonial president. His father was born under British colonialism in Kenya, and there's a way in which he understands and speaks to a world that is in the midst of my friend, mentor Zbigniew Brzezinski talks about the global political awakening, and I think Obama gets that. I'll just give you a brief anecdote that reinforces your point about what's different and valuable about it. I'm told that on those key days when the Tahrir Square revolution was happening and the United States had to decide what to do as its key Middle East ally, Hosni Mubarak, was in danger of falling, that Obama said in the Situation Room to his advisors, "I know what this is. I saw this as a boy when I lived in Jakarta. I've seen what a corrupt dictatorial regime is and what it does to people." If you read his autobiography, his stepfather was sort of caught up in the regime and its corruption and difficulty. So he said, "I know what this is, and I know that it's bad." But then the second thing he said was, "I know what this is, and I know that we can't stop it even if we want to. That it has a momentum that's going to drive through." And I think that that was a decision that, in a sense, the president had to make from the gut. What am I going to do as Mubarak falls? And I think that, in this case, it was a gut that was informed by this very unusual experience, as you say. What I wish for Obama is that he would find a way to project these unusual characteristics, and I also should say, having sat and talked with him, an unusual intellect. I mean, you know, he may not be a Lyndon Johnson, you know, Bill Clinton, who'll grab you by the neck, but he is really analytically focused. If you talk to him about something, he is on every detail following it through. But he does need to find, to be the kind of leader that he wants to be, that the country needs, he's got to find a way to project it better. I'm sorry, I keep saying that, but I really do believe it. And I think that it's important for commentators like me, who I don't bear him any ill will, but to keep saying the president needs to lift his game, because if he doesn't, the opportunity that's there for him, I fear, will be lost.
Thank you. I'm Clemens Wagin, foreign editor of Die Welt. Mr. Ignatius, in Munich, I think everybody got the feeling that Salehi didn't bring with him any new message, and that the Iranians are still playing the old game of trying to gain time. Now, you said that Obama still is mystery for you, but maybe you still want to give us your bet on what Obama is going to do about Iran, if the Iranians are just going to keep on playing for time, and if he would be ready in the end, if everything else fails, to use military force, in your opinion.
I would say first that I share your analysis of the sum of what Salehi said. He was friendly without really making any new commitments. The administration has been signaling every way it can, publicly, privately, since before the election, that it wants to be in a bilateral discussion with Iran about how you find a diplomatic solution to this problem. And there have been a lot of formulas that Salehi has shared privately with all sorts of people for months. And that others, the Larijani brothers, have sent their own emissaries to share similar formulas. The problem is, as I understand it, every time the U.S. tries to track that back to the Supreme Leader so that it doesn't get caught in the situation it did in 2009, where you strike a deal and then they pull a football away, as in the Peanuts cartoon. So they wanted that reassurance. They're looking for that, for contact that's reliable. And I don't think Salehi moved that story forward. There's no question, as you look at this, that John Kerry, as he comes in as Secretary of State, chosen by the President with the understanding that he's the sort of person who could be an emissary, who would sound out, explore the terrain and see what sort of deal is possible, is you know, the plane is fueled, it's ready to go. If that plane doesn't take off, if in the end, the Iranians decide to play for time. And if the Iranians decide, as one of their senior officials said recently, the Americans just pulled out of two wars, why would they want to go to war with us? We're stronger than Iraq or Afghanistan, and they couldn't win in those places. Why would they do this? It would be crazy for them to do it, so they don't think we will. So my own judgment, and in the end, everybody, including the Iranians, is going to have to make up their minds about this. My own feeling is that an American president cannot say publicly that he's committed to a policy of prevention of the acquisition of nuclear weapons and not deliver. I think the idea that we could flip back to a policy of containment, accepting an Iranian nuclear weapons capability misunderstands Obama in the situation. So the need to find a diplomatic solution, and I think if you're not along that road by midsummer, you've got a problem. I think that's urgent. And I my own guess would be that if this is really as deadlocked as it seems now, financial markets will begin to reflect that. I mean, I would think by May, June, the anxiety level, quite appropriately, would really pick up if there's no movement.
Thank you. Question here. John Fogarassi, former commercial attaché here from the U.S. Embassy, having served here and in South Korea. And my question is about South Korea. How do you view South Korean administration's views on North Korea? Is it more bluster, or do you think this time there's a real crisis brewing?
Well, the biggest problem, I think, with North Korea is that it's so opaque still that I don't think the United States government or anybody has an adequate answer to that. Understanding the new leader, Kim Jong-un, I think has been very difficult. Interpreting what he's trying to do, whether this is bluster, whether this is an attempt to consolidate his position with the military, what the right response is. I just don't think these are what known unknowns, as Rumsfeld would say. We know what the questions are, we just don't have answers for them. The biggest frustration for me about North Korea is that this rising China that wants to be a global power, for reasons that I don't understand, it's like watching Russian policy in Syria, for reasons that are mysterious, is prepared to allow this very unpredictable, potentially very destabilizing phenomenon to develop, where on its border you've got a leader who's threatening to shoot missiles to the United States, who goes through every red light, who defies every warning, and the Chinese don't seem willing to rise to the challenge of dealing with that. I don't get it. When I go to China with groups to talk to Chinese officials, and you try to say, why don't you step up to your responsibilities as a great power, commensurate with your economic power? Why don't you play a similar strategic role? And you just don't get answers. The Chinese just don't want to deal with that question. So I would say, looking at administration policy on North Korea, it's a significant failure. I don't think they have any better answers yet, but as with Syria, the answer to that lies in Moscow. I wrote this week, our policy should be to win the Nobel Peace Prize for Vladimir Putin. Our policy should be to make Xi Jinping the hero of Asia for finding a way to ramp down the North Korean threat. But how do you do that? That's beyond me. I'm just a journalist.
It sounds very much like leading from behind, very cleverly. There's one more question.
I'm Hermann von Richthofen, former ambassador. Mr. Ignatius, you just said that you believe that the financial markets or the euro crisis will re-flicker in May or June. This is not what I heard in Munich. I neither heard it from Mr. Schäuble nor from Herr Steinmeier. You cannot hear it also from Chancellor Merkel, and Mr. Steinbrück made an important speech today in London. You also did not express this view. What brings you to this assessment?
I may have said something that was subject to misunderstanding. I don't think that financial markets are going to resume their anxiety about Europe in May, June, absent some significant change of course, which I don't have to anticipate. I think that the Eurozone is coming back together, that the combination of Chancellor Merkel and Mario Draghi and all the other positive actors are producing, I think you just feel the tension go out of the financial nervous system about the Eurozone. I was talking about something different, which was the danger that the Iranian situation, which I think financial markets have kind of discounted now for a while, that if we don't have progress, I would say by late spring, early summer, people are going to begin to think, we're still on a collision course. My another mentor, Graham Allison at Harvard, talks about the Iranian nuclear crisis as the Cuban Missile Crisis in slow motion, meaning that absent creative diplomacy, these ships are still, heading for each other. They're heading for a collision, and that it's slow motion, so you don't think about it, but it's still there. And I think that's right.
Gary.
David, before Theo closes, you're not just a journalist, you're also a very well-known and successful novelist. He's written 8 novels. The 7th was filmed, stars Leonardo DiCaprio and Russell Crowe. I mean, you have Jessica Chastain in your next film. And so you were sitting in Munich in the really impressive cyber war, the cyber debate as a journalist, and the last 2 days you've been sitting with hackers, which has been our job to provide them, planning your next novel. Do you want to talk a little bit about that threat? I found that I asked my neighbor if Allianz insures against cyber crime, but the risks are pretty incalculable at this point.
Well, Gary, you've outed my secret visit. I do have this other life as a novelist. It's been very useful in paying the tuition bills for my 3 children. And I have spent some time here in Germany talking to hackers, going to bizarre places. I hope members of this audience never wander into some of the places I've been in the last couple days. But I should also say I've had the opportunity to meet some absolutely brilliant German former hackers who are now technicians and consultants trying to figure out ways to solve this problem. And I don't want to make an advertisement for them, but send me an email and I'll tell you who they are. I've talked to experts all over the world who are trying to get their minds around this problem and think about how businesses and governments should deal with it. And I have not heard any analysts who are more brilliant than these 2 Germans. So that should be reassuring to this audience that by my tour of your strange cyber underground reveals that you've got some really smart people with responsible ideas. So Gary, thank you. This is part of being here as an American Academy Distinguished Visitor is that I get to moonlight and do research for my novel. So that's been really great. Thank you.
3 copies to be delivered to the Academy, of course, to the scholars there. There's a story told about Albert Einstein when he, as a professor at university, handed to his secretary the questions for the exams. And the secretary looked at them and said, "Professor, these are the old questions from last year." And he replied, "Yes, the questions are the old ones, but the answers have changed." And listening to you, I was wondering what we will see. I mean, if Obama certainly, and I have sort of 2 more pages here of old questions facing the president. If he will give us new answers, if he gives old answers or no answers, which are answers as well. And you highlighted a lot of things with a lot of insight, and I'm very grateful, and I'm sure I can express that for everybody in the room here. Thank you very much. Being a journalist, I'm proud that a journalist can give good analyses. Thank you very much indeed for the evening.